Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hey, I know all that Halloween candy is long gone by now, at least if your house is like my house, but I hope you have some other nibblers ready to enjoy for tonight's encounter. Tonight's encounter was sent in to us by Miguel, who is a recently retired corrections officer from New Mexico. Miguel wanted to share his story with us tonight. Well, two stories, actually. So, my SAS squad, start your nibblers, because we're getting started right now. My first encounter, I was 13 years old. This was the mid-80s. I grew up in Taos, New Mexico. For those people who don't know too much about New Mexico, a lot of people think it's just desert. But northern New Mexico, where I grew up, is the start of the Rocky Mountains. I grew up with a single mother, so I spent a lot of time with my uncle growing up. He was more like my dad. We spent a lot of time in the outdoors fishing, hunting, and camping. We always had a great time just camping. So this one time we were going out to a new place we had never gone before. A place a friend of his told him about. About 60 miles away in Taos in the Jemez Mountains. On this trip, my aunt decided to come with us. Usually, she did not like to come when we went out into the woods. But this time, it was going to be a little bit longer trip. We were going to stay for around 4 days. We got there a little later than we anticipated, but the place did not disappoint. It was beautiful. A nice little river ran through it, and it had beautiful trees. We set up camp, and it was starting to get dark. We got our fire going, and my aunt cooked us some dinner. After that, my aunt went to bed. She would take sleeping pills to help her fall asleep, so she was out for the night. Me and my uncle stayed up talking, and he was telling me stories of when him and my grandpa used to go hunting and camping together. Just about that time, we were getting ready to go to bed when we heard what is now considered the wood knock. I asked my uncle, "What the heck was that?" My uncle's dog was with us, and the dog started going off. My uncle said, "Maybe it's a woodpecker." But by the look on his face, I know that's not what he was thinking, and I had heard a woodpecker before, and it was a completely different sound. The sound we heard was coming east of us. Then a few seconds later, we heard another one. Three loud bangs on a tree, and that was coming from the west. At this time, we're looking at each other. What the heck was going on? Just then, the breeze changed direction and blew the most nasty, pungent, make-your-eyes-water kind of smell into the camp. The dog was going crazy. My uncle's dog was a big red-nosed pit bull, and it was pretty damn mean. Then we heard two more knocks coming from the east. At this time, my uncle took the dog off the leash, and my uncle told the dog, "Go." He ran into the woods, and then you could hear him attacking something fiercely for about 20 seconds. Then we heard the dog yelp, and the dog ran back into the camp and was shaking in fear and then hid behind my uncle. At this time, my uncle went to the truck and got his 30-30 lever action, and he chambered around. We could hear something moving through the woods approximately 75 yards from us, but we really couldn't see anything past the firelight. It took us a couple of hours to calm down from all the commotion, but the rest of that night was pretty quiet, although the dog was on alert. I did not sleep too well that night. I don't think my uncle did either, although my aunt woke up in the morning and she said she didn't hear any of it. My uncle said maybe there was some other campers around and they were just trying to mess with us. So me and my uncle decided to walk around and see if we saw any other camps or anything in the area. We looked for a while, but did not see anything. No signs of any other people out there. He said they must have been pretty early in the morning. I went down to the river to get us some sodas. We had dammed up a little spot in the river to keep the sodas and a huge watermelon cool. We had made the dam out of rock. When I got there, most of the sodas were pulled up out of the river and were on the bank. That huge watermelon was gone. I called for my uncle. He came down to where I was and said, "What the heck is going on?" I showed him the sodas thrown all over and that the watermelon was gone. I asked my uncle, "What could take a huge watermelon that big?" He said the only thing he could think of was a bear. But there was no sign of a bear, and there was no watermelon shell anywhere. We went back to the camp. Later on that afternoon, my uncle said, "Let's go and pick some firewood for tonight." We were picking some wood, and I was right on the tree line, just past where the hill sloped down to an open meadow with tall grass on the other side of the meadow. I could see something in the grass, so I hand-signaled to my uncle to come and take a look. He whispered, "That must be the bear that took the watermelon." We stood watching it for a couple of minutes. It was slumped down like it was eating something. I would say it was maybe 350 to 400 yards away. Just then it put its head up. It did not have the head of a bear. It started sniffing the air. Then it stood up on two legs and sprinted into the tree line, which was about 30 yards away from where it was. It was light brown in color and appeared to be pretty tall, but kind of hard to tell just how tall because we were far away from it. I looked at my uncle, and he looked pale like he had seen a ghost. He was not a man that would scare easily, because he was a pretty big man himself, 6'3", probably about 240 pounds. I asked him, "What was that?" And that was no bear. He just looked at me and did not say anything for about 30 seconds. Then he says, "Let's just head back to camp." He said, "Don't tell your aunt what we saw. She will get scared." I was thinking to myself, I'm already scared. And although he would never admit it, I know that he was too. When we got back to camp, he was very quiet, and he was not that type of person at all. Most of the time, you couldn't get him to shut up. He kept the rifle right next to him. After dinner, my aunt again went to bed early, and we stayed up. I asked him again, "What was that?" And he said he was pretty sure it was just a bear. But the look on his face and the way he was acting told me different. Then my uncle told me to go sleep in the tent. He decided he wanted to sleep outside. I was in the tent for maybe 15 minutes. But I could not fall asleep at all, thinking of what we had seen. Just then I heard two loud wood knocks, and they sounded pretty close, closer than the night before. I heard the dog growling, but he was not barking like he was the night before. I heard my uncle pick up the rifle. I decided I did not want to be in the tent either. I came out and joined my uncle. Just then, the same smell came into the camp as the night before. Then we heard a whooping sound from the opposite area from where the three knocks had to come from. Earlier in the day, I had found a good walking stick, so I picked up that stick, and I started sharpening a point on it. My uncle said nothing. We kept the fire burning bright all night, and I would doze off. Then I would wake up, and my uncle would still be awake. But when he saw that I was awake, he would doze off. Once the sun started to rise, we both dozed off for a while. My aunt woke us both up about 8 in the morning and said for us to go get more firewood to make breakfast because we had burned it all up. She said, "Why did you guys burn so much firewood last night?" We did not tell her anything. My uncle said that he wasn't feeling all that good and for us to just pack up camp and head back. We'll just get breakfast at a restaurant when we get to town. Whenever you would let the dog off the chain, he would always take off and you would have to try and catch him. But not this time. I let him off the chain and I opened the tailgate of the truck. He was more than happy to just jump inside and lie down in the corner of the truck. The rest of the way home, my aunt asked us why we were so quiet. We just said we were tired. Before that, I had only maybe heard of Bigfoot or Sasquatch once and thought it was something that had died out hundreds of years before. I told people soon after what I had seen. That's when my friend's dad, who was from the Pacific Northwest, said, "You saw a Bigfoot." After that, I went to the local library and found a book on Bigfoot, and there were some pictures and some drawings that other people had made, and it looked just like what I had seen in the meadow that day. Any time that I would bring that up, my uncle would always change the subject. We never went overnight camping again, and 2 years later, my uncle moved to a city 5 hours away, so we didn't spend as much time together. Even years later, after I was an adult, my uncle still would change the subject when I would bring it up. This was my first encounter. Now, Miguel's second encounter. After a few years and after growing up, I didn't have any more experiences any time I was in the woods. I just thought it must have been my childhood imagination. It had gotten the best of me all those years ago. Then I was 32. This was in 2004. I had not drawn a deer tag for the New Mexico's Game and Fish Lottery that year, but a buddy of mine said that he was going bear hunting, and a bear tag you can just buy over the counter. Well, I had never gone bear hunting before, so I thought, well, I'll give it a try. We were supposed to go together, but the night before the season started, my buddy called me up and said that he was not going to be able to go for the first couple of days because something came up. Well, I had already taken the time off work, so I decided I would just go by myself. I got up early that morning and decided to go to a place called Bear Wallow, where I have seen bear before, hence the name, I guess. I got there a little before sunrise. I poured me a cup of coffee from my thermos. When I was done, I was on my way, hiking an old logging road. I would hike a little bit, then stop and look around. I saw a lot of sign of bears, and I did see some elk. After about 3 hours, I stopped and decided to take a break. I was drinking some water and eating a granola bar. I was sitting on a fallen tree, thinking that I should probably start heading back because if I had a kill, it would take me a long time to pack it out of there. Just then, a large mule deer buck comes running down the logging trail, runs right past me, and does not even acknowledge me, but continues running. Something's really swoop on that deer. I thought maybe a bear or a cougar was after him, so I got my rifle ready and hid behind some brush. After about 20 minutes of waiting there with nothing going on, I decided I better start heading back. I had just put my pack back on when I heard two loud wood knocks that nearly made me jump out of my boots. I got my rifle ready, then all of a sudden there came that unmistakable smell, and it took me right back to that experience I had as a kid. Just then, something was thrown at me from the hill above the logging trail. It landed in some bushes right behind me. I don't know what it was for sure, but from the sound, I'm guessing it was a large rock. I turned around and yelled at whatever threw something at me, yelling, "Get out of here!" Then I heard a loud grunt and something like small trees being shook. I took aim with my 7mm mag towards the top of the hill where the sound was coming from. I could not see anything through the scope, but I decided to fire a round into a large tree that was on the top of the hill. When I did that, the sound of the tree shaking stopped. It felt like my heart was going to beat right out of my chest. I took a second to collect myself and chambered another round. Then I took off jogging down the trail. I really can't say that I was running, because I'm a pretty big man, but I would jog a little ways, then stop and look behind and around me. It took me about an hour and a half to get back to my truck, which was about half the time it took me to get up to where this event occurred. The whole way down, I could feel that I was being watched, and I could smell the stench the entire way down. I will tell you one thing, I was never happier to see my truck than that day. I got to my truck, and in my center console, I always kept a half pint of Jack Daniels for emergencies. I started my truck and downed that half pint in two drinks and was out of there. No, I don't know what that was, but I have my suspicions. Since then, I've never went hunting by myself anymore. Although I tried to forget the experiences with the popularity of these shows like Finding Bigfoot and Mountain Monsters and such, it brought a lot of that back to me. As a matter of fact, I did not know there were so much sightings in the Hamas Mountains. I thought maybe it was just my imagination when I was a kid. But when Finding Bigfoot did a special about the sightings in that area, it confirmed what I saw as a kid and that what I had been telling my family all those years ago was the truth. I think now they believe me a little bit more, and now my uncle has admitted that he did not think it was a bear. He just did not want to believe that it wasn't. If you decide to put my story on your channel, you can use my name. Thanks, Miguel. If you like what you've heard and want to hear more, hit the like and subscribe button, and don't forget the bell to get notifications. Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? If so, drop me an email at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com and tell me all about it. Then I'll share it with everyone. Well, that wraps it up for tonight. We'll be meeting up again this Friday for another Buckeye Encounter, so get those nibblers ready. Until then, I'm Nance Warren, and I'll be putting the sass into Sasquatch. And you? You're my Sasquatch, and you'll be poking under rocks and shining your flashlights into all the dark corners of the forest, looking for evidence. As always, while you're doing that, remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening.